Hey, I'm Kara Gashuro, and welcome to Let It Rip. We're coming to you from the CUNY TV studios in the shadow of the Empire State Building in New York City. This is a special presentation of Let It Rip, and I will be your moderator for today's episode, where we will be televising our first city council political debate for District 9, which includes Central Harlem, Morningside Heights, the Upper West Side, and East Harlem. Now, District 9 is one of the hottest contested city council seats, and there are three Democratic candidates in this primary race. But before we get to the candidates, I want to share some information about the importance of the City Council. The City Council is New York City's legislative body, which has 51 council members and is responsible for, but not limited to, constituent services, zoning issues, land use decisions, passing city laws, oversight of city agencies, as well as negotiating and approving the city's budget, which is currently at $106.7 billion and often surpasses the budget of other states. Wow. Now, we are lucky to have here in our studio the three Democratic candidates who want to represent District 9. Now, it should be noted that the current incumbent, Councilmember Kristen Richardson Jordan, recently announced she will not be seeking re-election in the Democratic primary, which will be held on Tuesday, June 27, 2023. So the current candidates are Inez Dickens, who is the current State Assembly member for Assembly District 70, Al Taylor, who is the current State Assembly member for Assembly District 71, and Yusef Salaam, who is a community activist and member of the Exonerated Five. I'm Kara Gashuro, and this is Let It Rip. I have the distinct honor and privilege of presenting today's debate with the former anchor and reporter for New York One and the current correspondent of Asian American Life on CUNY TV, the amazing Vivian Lee, along with former New York City Council member and host of Keeping Relevant, also on CUNY TV, the great Ronnie Eldridge. Now, here are the rules for today's debate. Each candidate will be given 1 minute for their opening statement and 1 minute for their closing remarks. Each candidate will have 60 seconds to respond to myself or my panelists' questions. A candidate addressed or referred to by another candidate will be given 30 seconds to respond. There will be no show of hands or down-the-line questions. All questions will be asked by myself or panelist, with an equal number of questions given to each candidate for each segment. If needed, answers to questions by candidates can be followed up on by myself or the panel for further clarity in today's debate. Now, today's debate will be focusing on four key policy areas: affordable housing, youth services and higher education, economic development, and public safety. Mr. Yusef Salaam, we will begin with your opening statement regarding your past experiences and vision for District 9.
Thank you. It is definitely an honor and a privilege to be here before you to share my vision for what Harlem needs for its future. You know, I'm not new to Harlem. Of course, I was born and raised here. My family still lives here, and I am here as well. Many of the conditions and the policies that we've experienced have been here long before this current election. And the great thing about it is that we need new leadership, new eyes, new experiences that will give us a way forward. The best thing about me is that I represent that new leadership. I represent that new direction. Harlem is a renaissance that we hope that we can resuscitate. And the beautiful thing about what I propose is that you get an opportunity to have that same renaissance resuscitated with what I bring to Harlem. Okay. We're lacking much of the things that we need, and I didn't create those things, but I'm here to make sure that we have brand new eyes and brand new experiences to address them.
Thank you, Mr. Salaam. Assemblymember Inez Dickens, your opening statement.
Thank you, and I want to give a moment to former Senator and Councilmember Bill Perkins, who passed yesterday. I wanted to acknowledge him. I am Inez E. Dickens. I have served in the New York City Council for 12 years. I have now, in my seventh year, in the New York State Assembly. I am the one candidate that has the experience. I served in leadership as the Deputy Majority Leader in the New York City Council, having sat at the table for budgeting. I chaired city planning, committee, which gave me the experience, the knowledge, and the aptitude to negotiate for the powerful land use items that were coming before the city council. I am very honored that the community elected me to do so, because with all new ideas, it's still the same system that must be worked into. And that is the funding of any development, the funding of all projects. Thank you.
Thank you, Assemblymember Dickens. Assemblymember Al Taylor, your opening statement.
Hi, good afternoon. I am Assemblymember Al Taylor. I'm ecstatic to be here. I am a resident of Harlem, grew up in Harlem, a former dropout, joined the military with a high school, without a high school diploma, was able to become a military police officer at that time. So I understand transformation, opportunities. Education is a game changer. An experience that gives you trade is an experience that prepares you for life. So I'm here to fight for this seat. I am an Assemblymember for the last 7 years, 2017, and I'm excited to be here because the people elected me, so I get to work, live, and serve in my community, fighting for more equal economic development, making sure we have real, deep, affordable housing, making sure that people that find themselves in substance issues have a way out, whether it's second, third, or fourth chances. Let's make that happen. And certainly, we need to beef up and work to make sure that public safety and police are one in the same, and having that conversation where we're not at odds with each other, but actually having a dialogue that's transformative, not only for the community, but the future of Harlem. Thank you.
Thank you, Assemblymember Taylor. Now, for our first segment, we will focus on public safety. Now, Mayor Eric Adams announced a pay boost for the NYPD amid budget cuts for other city departments. Do you believe more money allocated to the NYPD best addresses crime in our city? And what are the specific steps you would take to properly address crime in the district? We will start with you, Mr. Salaam.
So one of the things that I've been looking at as it relates to the budget has been where we can spend money smarter. Providing more money to police department, I think, is a good thing. But the fact of the matter is that many of our people lack a living wage. And so if we're gonna give to one, we have to give to others. We have to ensure that we look at how we can make our enforcement smarter. We need police to focus on major crime. We need police, I think we should have police to be living in the cities that we are in. You know, we should make sure that they live where they serve. The good thing about it is that we get the opportunity to examine all of this in light of what's going on and decide how can we spend smarter and not just spend just because.
Assemblymember Dickens.
Thank you. Funding to NYPD has to be reviewed like with all city agencies. At the city council, when we have budget hearings, they come in, all the city agencies come in to present why they need additional funding and how it will be spent. The NYPD has to be held to the same procedures that all New York City agencies are held to. So I'm not advocating for additional funding nor defunding the police. Absolutely not, because we need them. What we do need is police community relations to be improved. What we do need is a regular dialogue and engagement with regular meetings, such as the meetings that we have at each precinct council meeting monthly, so that there is an open dialogue between the community and the police that are actually serving in that district. And I think that that would help to further positive relations with the police.
Thank you, Assemblymember Dickens. Assemblymember Taylor?
Same question?
Yes, sir.
Absolutely. I do not have a problem with them receiving funding, but I would like to make sure that we're spending it wisely, making sure where we can trim the fat. So if you're bringing new technology and it brings more, then let's look at that. But also, I think that to my colleague's point, if we're doing community relationships, we can't legislate our way out of this, and we can't police our way out of this. It's going to require that we bring boots to the ground. People will get their hands in it and skin in the game, as they say. So you have uniform. You have uniform folks working with TA presidents and community folks, so you get to know who they are. The beat cops make a big difference once you start to know who they are. So I'm not about defunding the cops, but let's get them to work smarter. And if there's more money that they need, I don't have a problem with that. But let's make sure we're bringing resources to the other entities that need it as well.
All right. Thank you, Assemblymember Taylor.
candidates, the next question I'd like to pose to you is adjacent but separate and linked to the question of whether the police should have more of a presence in our communities. And it has to do with the Civilian Complaint Review Board. Some deem it deeply ineffective. It has been reported that the NYPD has rejected more than half of the Civilian Complaint Review Board's recommendations for discipline of New York City officers who have perpetrated misconduct. So my question to you is, what steps should be taken to foster greater police accountability? And Assemblymember Taylor, could you take this one first?
Oh, great. Thank you so much. Great question. Accountability. I think this is all about accountability. I would look to see how we can effectively bring change so that the recommendations that are there, that are being presented by the CC community, Civil Complaint Review Board, Citizens Review Board, are taken seriously. But then also, can we partner with perhaps our state legislators and say, you must do this there? So for example, I created legislation that passed, the governor signed it, that if officers are exhibited to have done something wrong and there's an officer with him at that time, that person is liable to make sure that they report it, and the attorney general's office have to look at it. So I would like to sit down and look at it and see how we can forge and create a path to success so that it's just not spinning their wheels when they put something out there.
Okay, thank you, Assemblymember Taylor. Assemblywoman Dickens.
CCRB needs to have a board that is diverse in color, in culture, across the board, representative of the city of New York, the residents of the city of New York. I think that if that is done, and I'm proud to say that Arva Rice, who is from the community, the National Urban League Harlem chapter, is now on the CCRB from the Harlem community, I am sure that that's going to be a first step. But the important thing with the CCRB and the complaints that many people have mm-hmm. is because the CCRB has had so many one-sided appointments on the board. And that creates an atmosphere that is suspect and creates where maybe decisions are made that are adversarial to what many of the community feels. Mm-hmm. So I am hopeful that part of what the city council can do is to ensure that the board changes at the CCRB so that we can have a diversity and an openness with the board and the decisions. And I think that that will create an atmosphere where it'll be more positive.
Mr. Salaam.
Yes, thank you. I think that when I think about what we're talking about, what we're experiencing, we're talking about justice and safety. And we're talking about a board that is able to review the grievances in the community. And many times, if that is handled in a way where it's like the police department is investigating the police department, what they usually find is that they did no wrong. The truth of the matter is that if there are grievances out there, we need to end things like qualified immunity. Because if the police do wrong, and I'm not saying that there are always unrighteous actors in that space. There are very righteous actors in that space. I met many of them. But the truth of the matter is that we need people who are going to truly protect and serve all people in our community, as opposed to some. I think we've been lacking the justice that we need. We need service that supports us as opposed to divestments in our community. And I think that that is about inclusion as opposed to exclusion.
So my questions are to all of you. Inez, maybe you should start since you haven't had the pleasure of doing so. Some of the crime, the recent instances of subway crime have underscored the city's need, growing needs to address the mental health crisis. So when you talk about the budget, do you also see increasing funding for some of the other agencies?
Absolutely. Mental health was gutted for years in the city council, on the state level, and on the federal level. So it's imperative, and in the governor's budget this year, it hasn't been signed off, but she has proposed additional funding for mental health. That is absolutely the basis of what is going on, part of the issue that is impacting upon communities and has caused additional issues with violence, with domestic violence as well as violence on the streets. So I agree that it's very, very important. I, at the City Council, fought along with my colleagues to have increased funding for the mental health issues, which have been closed up. Many of the centers have been closed up. Many of the centers have had decreased funding and have had to cut staffing, and the patients are not followed up on.
Thank you. Thank you. Reverend?
Yeah, same question?
Yeah.
Absolutely. I think when I spoke earlier about funding for law enforcement, if we look at it and see how the money is being used and trim what we can trim and send folks that have the qualifications to come in and deal with mental health issues. So rather than sending someone that's law enforcement to a place, why don't we send someone that's qualified into the community, create in these communities people that deal with mental health? Because right now, there are not enough beds in our system. You shouldn't lose your life because you have a mental issue. We saw that just about a week or so ago here in New York City. So there are a lot of real problems that we've neglected, to your point, for so many years. And people are feeling, I'm going to use the term vigilantes, that they feel that they need to step in and do something. We cannot solve the problem by creating another problem. So certainly we need to have more resources in there for mental health.
Thank you. And Yusef, so you have the final word.
Yes, absolutely. You know, mental health is, it's always been a bad thing because it's been stigmatized. And when I think about mental health, we're all dealing with mental health challenges. You know, things like paid time off is dealing with mental health. People need to be able to take time off from their job so that they can reset. You know, the challenge here is that we're talking about resources and the lack thereof. And in Harlem, we've been a dumping grounds for all of the bad things that we've been experiencing. You know, it's almost like we can point to Harlem and say it's happening there. Really, we need to point to Harlem and say hope is happening there. And so therefore, the same services that we need in our community have to reflect that. We need to make sure that we have a budget that is utilized wisely, that wrap around our community, and make sure that we have services that support us as opposed to divestments. And so I think that giving a budget that helps to have more mental health services is important.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Well, thank you all. Wow, we're off to a great start. That will conclude our first segment on public safety for our New York City Council Democratic primary debate for District 9. We'll take a short break, and when we come back, we'll discuss youth services and higher education. I'm Kerry Gashuro, and this is Let It Rip. Welcome back to Let It Rip. I'm Kerry Gashuro. As we continue our New York City Council Democratic primary debate for District 9, we'll move on to the second segment, which is youth services and higher education.
Candidates, my question has to do with the City University of New York. In lieu of proposed budget cuts to CUNY, a proposed $41.3 million total, the bulk of which would come from staff reductions, how do you plan to address CUNY's funding woes? And Assemblyman Taylor, could you please take the first answer?
Yes, Ms. Lee, great question. I think leveraging our relationships with our colleagues on the state side and on the federal side to bring more resources, but also we just, in this past budget, were able to fend off tuition increases to the students that are living in New York City, continue those fights, fighting for the New Deal. We need more money on the table and making sure that those that can afford at least have to pick up that fare, that tab. I am a CUNY graduate. I know what it meant for me to transform my life walking to school because I had no car fare. But once I got that degree, my whole life I've been up on a trajectory that changed everything about me. So it's a fight. It's a dogfight. I think tuition should be absolutely free. And before it shifted, it used to be free, and it should be free for all. It's a game changer. For every buck that's spent, we get $1.25 back for those that have graduated with a degree. We need to do more.
I just wanted to get a clarification. You said to find more resources and to keep make CUNY free once again. Could you just explain how that would address the funding woes?
Well, fighting with our state governor and our partners to bring more money. We needed more money. We didn't get more money. We asked for more money. I know SUNY got a little bit more. That's where it really starts. And then seeing where we can, again, save money, but it's got to start at the top to make sure that it happens. And it's been proven that, and I don't have the statistics in front of me, but if we went back to the free model, more folks would go, and we can make sure that the teacher's getting paid, and it would not hurt. There's a model out there, and I support it.
Thank you, Assembly.
Thank you.
Assemblywoman Dickens.
Vivian, when we talk about the staffing, it still goes back to funding. It requires funding, fair wages. It also requires the funding of the graduate students who work and are getting their degree. And so in the Assembly, This is proposed because it has not passed. It has not been signed off. The assembly put in $1.3 billion for CUNY. And I don't know what's going to happen with that because it has to be signed off on. And I wanted to be sure that the public did not think that that is the number, the final number. But the truth of the matter, it still goes back to funding. It still goes back to the federal government is going to have to pour into the state. It's going to have to pour into the city because the city is going to have to support the City University of New York. The state is going to have to support, just like it does SUNY, it's going to have to support CUNY because more students went to CUNY than SUNY, actually, as population count.
Thank you, Assemblywoman. Mr. Salaam.
Yes, thank you. You know, when I think about the budget itself, I think that it's been said that the budget is a moral document, but it's also an IQ test. When I think about where we have been spending our money, I know for a fact that we have the resources that we need. Taxation without representation is tyranny. And I don't want to say that we're living in tyranny, but I know that we don't have the support that we need from our tax dollars. And so therefore, the divestment that we've been experiencing is far and wide. When I think about CUNY and education in general, we're talking about a passport to the future. Mm-hmm. We're talking about a return on the dollars. Mm-hmm. We're talking about something that is so necessary that all we have to do is figure out how we can have appropriate funding in all of the buckets that we've been spending so that we get an opportunity to have proper investment where we need it.
Thank you, Mr. Salaam.
The student debt is the latest contribution to the growing disparity in wealth. And how are we going to address that economic burden? I mean, Inez?
As far as student debt?
Yeah.
You know, thankfully, you know, the president did relieve some student debt, some, you know, and it was small by comparison to what student debt actually is. One part, because the truth of the matter is, there is always going to be some type of student debt. What has to be done is that maybe instead of demanding it on their first job, maybe no interest could be done and only principal or half of it. Or if they take a job like they did with education, if you went into the city schools in the public school system, you got a break on the repayment of your student debt.
Thank you. Thank you. Sorry. Assemblyman, you said, and that was my next question, there should be no tuition fees.
Absolutely.
But how do you do that?
You put the money where you say it's important. You invest it.
What money?
The money that we don't have. So, for example, let me give
you. So, where do we get that money?
On the federal level. So.
Well, but we're not getting it from.
No, I understood. Now, yeah. I'm not gonna make it happen in this space. We all agree that it's not happening. But there's no way in God's green acres why they could not wipe the debt of those students in America. Or when we're paying for countries to survive and sending missiles in. It's more important to spend here. You get a return on your dollar. They're not doing it. So I will still say the federal government could have done more if the people would look at it and say, CUNY has the most black and brown non-traditional students happening in the world, and we're not undergirding them to get what they need because they're getting stuck with a burden. I have $500,000 debt between my kids and myself in school. The government can take that off, not just for me, but for ourselves, and relieve it the same way they've done other things in other places.
And Yusef?
So one of the beautiful things about where we are today, we are emerging out of the COVID-19 pandemic. In many ways, that emergence is also something that has reset the world. It behooves us to take this opportunity, just has been said already, to literally reset the debt as it relates to education. There's nothing wrong with doing debt forgiveness. I love the fact that we talked about things like incentives, because when we think about how we can incentivize the education process, we get the opportunity for more people to participate and thereby giving us a greater return mm-hmm. as people graduate and go on and become the first class producers in this first class society. Right now, we're second class. We're a first class
but
in the second class.
Where are we going to get more money?
We can first start by forgiving the debt.
Right. Thank you, Mr. Salaam. Assemblymember Dickens, yes. I want to come back to you on that question. Do you believe CUNY should be free?
CUNY was for free, you know, years ago. Mm-hmm. It was free till black and brown students started coming in, mm-hmm. to be honest about it. But today, because of the cost of living being so high, it's nearly impossible.
It's a 30-second rebuttal.
To be totally free. But what we can do is have the incentives that I spoke about so that the student debt is relieved and lowered.
Okay. So just to be clear, you don't believe CUNY should be free at this point?
It's not going to be totally free. It's not going to happen. I can wish it, but it's not going to happen.
All right. Thank you so much. All right. That was a great segment, and I know we all agree this is an extremely important issue that needs our undivided attention. So let's take a short break, and when we come back, we'll tackle a very important issue facing District 9, economic development. Once again, I'm Kerry Gashura, and this is Let It Rip. Welcome back. I'm Kerry Gashura, and this is Let It Rip. Now, as we continue our Democratic primary debate for District 9, presented by CUNY TV, we would like to shift gears and discuss some of the important economic issues facing the residents and community of District 9. Vivian, please take it away.
Thank you, Kerry. Candidates, a recent study finds that New York has the largest income inequality gap in the country. What are your proposals for improving the economic prospects of District 9? Mr. Salaam, would you take the first reply?
Yes, thank you. So we don't have a living wage that is meeting or equal to what's happening in the economy. And the challenge is that there's an illusion that things cost more. And because that illusion is there, we therefore have to pay more for the services that we desperately need, like food, clothing, and shelter. My five-part economic and equity agenda addresses economic justice, housing justice, human infrastructure, environmental justice, and justice and safety. And I think when I look at all of those things as it relates specifically to the economy itself, we have to first begin to start by providing a living wage that meets the demands of where we are, not the imagination of where we could be, because that's not justice.
Thank you, Mr. Salaam. Assemblymember Dickens?
I'm gonna let it rip a little bit. I think that promoting small business developments in a city such as New York, as diverse as New York is the key to real economic development. But it does require a combination of supportive policies and initiatives. For instance, a development, the National Urban League on 125th Street, with it, I was able to secure a $12 million that would be given to the 125th Street Improvement District for small businesses to be built and be able to survive on 125th Street. We must establish and expand financial assistance programs such as the Empowerment Zone that Congressman Rangel did, that has been expanded to other states and into the Bronx, because that gave not only grants, but it gave assistance to small businesses in their back room to help them to stay alive.
Thank you, Assemblymember Dickens. Assemblymember Taylor?
Hey, thank you all so much. Certainly, we have to start with a fair wage. We've been fighting, I continue to fight for more hourly wages. We should be up to almost $25 an hour. But also want to make sure that the small businesses, that the city invests in small businesses. They're the backbone of our community. And I think we want to punish landlords that keep commercial spaces vacant. And it's an opportunity to create a business, upstart a business. More money and resources to support MWBE businesses as well. Opposing our cuts that the mayor may put out there. And I mentioned earlier that when you invest in a proper education and people are working, you get $1.25 back in return for that. So we need living wages. We want to make sure that the rent is really affordable, because right now, if you got a raise and you get that raise, you can't afford to stay where you're staying. Our people, black and brown, are leaving Harlem and they're living in Pennsylvania, Connecticut, and Jersey, and driving in, and they hold jobs here, but they can't live here. We've got to change that narrative, and the money that they spend in those places could be spent here to drive the economy.
Thank you, Assemblyman Taylor.
Thank you.
Now, this question is also for all three of you. So there's been a sharp criticism directed towards both Mayor Eric Adams and the union leadership over a controversial plan to move 250,000
city retirees of traditional Medicare into a privately managed health care plan by Aetna. Now, Mayor Adams stated that this plan will lower deductibles and place a cap on out-of-pocket expenses. Retirees, however, have called on the New York City Council to intervene to maintain premium-free senior care. If elected to the City Council, would you support the privatization of health care for retired city workers? Mr. Salaam, we're going to go ahead and begin with you.
I think that the problem that we can very, like we all can, we can all bear witness to this. Every single one of us has a different health care plan, a different plan in general. Some of those plans do not lend its arm to the same things that the other plans may give. And so if we shift from one to the other and therefore demanding folks to get off of this and go on to this, there's a huge problem in that. And I know that the mayor has a momentous, a magnanimous job in front of him. The great thing about him is that he represents the value of what we really should be moving towards. But the truth of the matter is that I wouldn't support a plan that moves everyone off of what they have into privatization, because we need to look at all of the aspects of what that is so that we can move forward or not.
All right. Thank you, Mr. Salaam. Assemblymember Dickens, coming to you.
Well, I'm a New York City retiree, so okay. I've got a vested interest in that plan that you're talking about. Mm-hmm. And I also tried to do some research to determine the difference between what I have today and what I had before and what I have now moving forward. The mayor has proposed a plan that is very, very different. But there are some positive elements to it that we do not have or did not have in the former plan, because I did the research because I'm impacted upon it myself. And I haven't come to a full determination of which way, but it's the ship has sailed. It's gone that way. And unless the city council enacts legislation that reverses it, but the additional part of it is the funding has to be put in. So I am acutely aware of what the differences are, and there are some very positive things in the Aetna plan.
All right, thank you, Assemblymember. Assemblymember Taylor?
Hey, great question. I'm vaguely familiar with it, and I know that there were union issues. Some unions wanted this one, some wanted that. And I think people that have retired and understand that they were counting on this to work, because they're counting pennies like everybody else. Can I afford this? Am I losing services? I don't have the answer because I haven't dug down in that well far enough to find out. But I think we have to approach that very carefully to make sure. My off-the-cuff thought would be, what would it look like if you grandfather those that are there, and then people that are retired later, they would get something different. But the people that have retired, it leaves the question, what are they actually getting? Okay. What are they getting? It's being privatized. Are they taking pre-existing? I don't know, and I don't want to give an off-the-cuff answer in that one.
Assemblyman, I have the next question.
Yes.
Assemblyman Taylor. The sidewalk cafes and all the outdoor dining sheds and everything were the things that let local restaurants survive the pandemic, especially local restaurants in Harlem. Mm-hmm. So some people don't want to continue to keep those sheds because they say they take up side parking spaces and contribute more things to the environment. Do you support outdoor dining sheds?
I think it would be a case by case. I think that there should be a uniform way of what they should look like, because I've seen some stuff like Shantytown, and they need to go. And all it is a breeding place for rodents, and you couldn't pay me to eat in those spaces. So places like that need to be knocked down and create a standard and a code so people can use those. They were the lifeblood of our communities. That's the only place you could eat 3 years ago.
So how would you decide which sheds should go? Who would do that in the city?
Well, I would look to the folks that created the newsstands. This is off the top of my head. I would look at the people that did the model, and I'm not saying that is the answer, but they uniformed all the newsstands and the subways in there. So bring someone together like that and figure out what they should look like, but there has to be a standard. And right now, there doesn't appear to be one.
Yeah. Inez?
although there's no standard, the mayor's office has already formed a cadre, a sub-agency, I call it, that is and has already started knocking down those that there have been a lot of complaints about, because there has been an increase in rodents. As we all know, he's got now a rodent commissioner, and he's changed the time from 3 to 5. I didn't know that rodents had a watch, but in any case, the fact is that that he has already started that. There is no standardization for them, and that's what needs to be, because in many instances, they're built above the ground and they're unable to, above the street level, and they're unable to get in and clean. And when food is dropped and the winds blow, it means that garbage gets under there, it stays there and harborage, and then the rodents go and fester.
Thank you. Thank you. Yusef?
I think they should go. I think they should go because when we think about why they were there in the first place, they were there as a response to health safety issues. We needed to still be able to experience life, mm-hmm. you know? And the truth of the matter is that pre-pandemic, we did have outdoor spaces. There were places that had tables and chairs and things of that nature mm-hmm. outside of their establishment so that if a person so chose, they got the opportunity to experience the great outdoors while they ate. The good thing about it is that we are out of the pandemic. And so therefore, in our new normal, we can go back to as much normal as we had before, therefore quelling the problem that the rats and the rodents and all of those things bring. And the good thing about it is that we've already had the example of what was. And so if we go back to that model of what was, outdoor spaces already there, tables there, chairs there, providing opportunity for parking spaces to be brought back, I think that's a win for all of us.
All right. We'll take a short break, and when we come back, we'll discuss affordable housing. I'm Kerry Gashiro, and this is Let It Rip. Hey, I'm Kerry Gashiro, and welcome back to Let It Rip. We're pleased to present to you the only televised Democratic primary debate for District 9. And we are joined by all three candidates in the race, Mr. Yusef Salaam, Assemblymember Inez Dickens, and Assemblymember Al Taylor. Now, without question, one of the most hotly contested issues facing District 9 is affordable housing. Community polling suggests this is the number one issue facing the district. So without further ado, let's jump right into it and let it rip. Now, with the growing rates of gentrification and displacement of people of color, what is your plan to ensure that longtime residents and the history of Harlem will be protected? Assemblymember Dickens, we'll begin with you.
The New York City uses the ULURP method, which is the Uniform Land Review, that helps to review the standardized procedures that when they look at an application, it ensures of the protects the affordability of any development that is either gut rehabbed or built new. And that's very important that that be maintained. However, right now, the mayor has usurped the ULURP process for some of the hotels that are vacant in order to create housing for people that are coming in, the asylum seekers that are coming in. And I don't know whether that's so good or not, because when it's converted to actual housing, will that ULURP process then be put in place? And that's a strong component. 421A is non-existent now, but there's an Article 11 that can be used to help with affordability.
Thank you, Assemblymember. Come back to you, Mr. Salaam.
Yes, you know, the thing about Harlem, Harlem's such a special place that it's known the world over. You know, when I've traveled, you know, the great thing about people is that when you tell them that you're from New York, they light up. When you tell them that you're from Harlem, they're like, whoa, you're like from the place where everything has created culture around the world that reverberates. When we think about affordable housing and what we need to make sure that we have a program that preserves existing housing. We need to make sure that we provide subsidies like Section 8 for individuals who need them. We need to ensure also that we fight the rent increases that are there, because the rent increases speak to something that we don't have, which is a living wage. We need to protect tenant laws. And also, we need to incentivize new construction so that when they come in, they give people who are there, who live in the community, an opportunity to participate in this new economy, making us a green beacon around the world?
All right. Thank you, Mr. Salaam. Assemblymember Taylor.
Hey, great question. Wow. Definitely we need to have a living wage, but we need real affordable housing. We must stop the bleed. According to the last census, more blacks left Harlem than any other time in the last 10 years. We have to stop that bleed. One bill, maintain what's there, and try to increase. So if our children go off to school, they should be able to come back, find affordable housing, stay there, raise their kids, and not be forced to go to one of the neighboring states because they get good salary, but they can't live where they grew up. They can't afford to live. So I think if we do that, so when we're bringing in new developments like the 145, that's a truck stop right now, we need to look at that and say, how do we fix this to make that it makes sense? And when we first got jerked, I would say we, Harlem, they connected the AMI, the area medium income on a federal level with Bergen County, New Jersey, in Westchester. And so when the bank started to lend money, they understood they could get a return on the investment based on the people that lived in those places, and the people that lived in Harlem got squeezed out, pushed out.
Thank you, Mr. Taylor. Well, actually, you indicated 145, so that's going to be the next question. The current council member, Kristen Richardson Jordan, was very vocal of our opposition, you know, to the 145 project. You know, and promised to bring a 900-plus unit development on West 145th Street in Harlem, which was going to be brought in by the developer, Bruce Teitelbaum. Now, it was also reported that Mr. Teitelbaum pledged to increase the number of below-market rate units to 50%. But then Councilmember Jordan was unsatisfied, arguing that most of the housing wasn't affordable to Harlem residents. Was Councilmember Jordan correct in not supporting this project? And is providing 50% below market rate sufficient to meet the housing needs for District 9? Mr. Salaam, we'll come back to you first.
50% below market rate of what? AMI. So the AMI, as we just heard, has pulled in places like Westchester and Rockland County. And the worst part about what we're experiencing is that pulling in those two places into Harlem has given us an AMI, an area median income, saying that the median income in our area is $80,000. We can just look around and know that that's not true. The real median income in our community is about $30,000. The truth of the matter is that when I think about the 145 project and how things unraveled, we can learn a lot from that. Because we're talking about negotiations and we're talking about making sure that we walk away from the table having won something in addition to the developer winning as well. That's what negotiations are about. I would not have walked away from that negotiation without receiving something better than what happened, because right now we have a truck stop that's affecting all of our community in a place that we have the most respiratory illnesses.
Assemblymember Dickens?
Mandatory inclusionary housing requires only 80-20, which is woefully insufficient. With 50%, and yes, the AMI is based upon not only New York City, but Bergen County in New Jersey, which has increased it. However, without 421A, the affordability is severely impacted and is scaring me. The current sitting city council member is now accepting, at least verbally she said it in the media, the new plan that has been filed by the developer at the 145. However, the use, and he's going to have to use something like Article 11, which will then allow for shelter rent to be paid, which will keep what the federal standards are for rent at 30% of what your of what an adjusted income is. And so it's a convoluted, very creative way, but it's necessary that something is done if we're going to really have affordable housing.
Assemblymember Taylor, go ahead.
Same question?
Yes.
I would not have left the table until we brokered something. I think there's too much that can be done there. So he did make some concessions, but I'm going to ask for more. And we're going to meet in the middle somewhere to make sure we're getting the best. Because also, this is jobs. This is opportunity for jobs. We talk about living wage. We talk about union jobs. We talk about black and brown folks having earned income and being able to get and stay in that community. That's a game changer right there. So it's not just about people moving in there, but people that live there can get jobs and stay there that are already blue-collar workers that need to be there. So for me, I would advocate to make sure that we're bringing what we need to bring and simultaneously fighting to make sure that the people in the community, in the borough of Manhattan, in the city, have counsel when they go to housing court. That's the biggest thing going on right now. As soon as we came out of the pandemic, people are being forced out.
Thank you, Assemblymember. Mm.
So let's go back. I guess Assemblyman Taylor, I always start with you. So
I'm all right with you. That.
Let's talk about 421A. The program is set to expire in June, mm-hmm. and that is the property tax exemption given to the real estate developers if they will simply set aside free money to developers in other places. So would you support extending the 421A?
Not in its current form. I think it's important that people understand, yes, it's helpful, but it's more helpful for small black and brown developers than it is for the bigger ones. Right. So I would love to see how we can craft something, but in its current state, I'm not interested, but we're having conversations even now.
Okay, thank you.
Yes, ma'am.
421A is critical, and it's not actually an exchange of money. It's really done on paper because there's no money exchanged to the developer or to the resident, and it impacts negatively upon our Mitchell Lamas, who are in buildings that are 421A, and now they're going their monthly maintenance is going to increase significantly if there is no subsidy put in, such as a 421A. Now there were issues with 421A. There's no doubt about it, but and the oversight was poor. Now, was that the legislature's fault, or was that somebody else's fault? But there needed to be oversight. But the bottom line is, it's still needed. 421A is needed in order for the seniors, for those that are living in Mitchell Lamas, those that are in the HDFCs. I'm sorry.
Go ahead. Thank you. You, sir.
So the question is,
would you support the renewal of 421A?
I would not.
Thank you.
We are going to leave it right there. Undoubtedly, affordable housing is a hot issue for District 9 and for all New Yorkers. Now, we want our audience to know that Let It Rip will be holding everyone accountable, especially on this issue. Now, let's take a short break, and when we come back, we'll take it up another level with our lightning round. I'm Gary Gachuro, and this is Let It Rip. Hey, I'm Kerry Gachuro, and this is Let It Rip. We are proud to present a televised Democratic primary debate for District 9. We thank all of the candidates for making themselves available on CUNY TV to share why they are the best candidate in this race to represent District 9 in the New York City Council. Now let's jump into the lightning round. The lightning round will be one individual question for each candidate. Each candidate will be given 60 seconds to respond. Ronnie, take it away.
So, Yusef, you're the only one of the three candidates who has not served in public office. And some of the critics say that you don't know enough about the workings of the government or the politics of it to adequately handle the various problems and challenges that the district has. So what do you say to them?
So the good thing about it is that I'm not a politician. So this is definitely not politics as usual. I get the opportunity to use my lived experiences to look at all of the problems that we're facing with brand new eyes. And I think that that's what we need. We've had many, many, many decades of policies that have ill affected Harlemites for a long time. And I think that when I look at what we are trying to do, we have to have an opportunity where we have someone who has fresh ideas, new minds, that we can approach this in a new way so we can really have success. And so even though I don't have the experience politically, I've been fighting for people in Harlem all my life.
Thank you.
Assemblymember Dickens, it has been reported that you've gained the support from Republican billionaire John Katsimatidis, who has contributed to your campaign. However, it has been reported that immigrant workers are leading one of the longest strikes in the United States against United Oil, an oil company owned by John Katsimatidis. Do you support the union workers on strike? And if you do, do you see the contradiction in accepting donations from Mr. Katsimatidis as well as supporting the union workers?
Well, let me correct. For this election, I have not received a donation in this election. I have maybe in the past, and that was based upon, not upon the strike, but based upon the fact that I felt that there were some issues. I had put through a bill where someone in the community had been attacked, an LGBTQ I and A had been attacked with feces and urine. and I'd put through a bill denouncing that they should be charged with doing that with anyone, regardless of who they are on any public transportation or the street. And that's what he was supporting, not me. I support the unions. I come from a union family. My uncle belonged to TWU1, Local 1, because he worked for the trains. My husband is Teamster, Local 804, UPS. My sister and my daughter both are UFT. So I come from a union family. I come from a family that fights for union rights. Thank you.
Thank you, Assemblymember. Just a 30-second follow-up on that. Mm-hmm. But it's been reported that it was actually John and his, Mr. Kasimaris and his wife, who donated $1,250 to your campaign, and that donation happened in December. Is that something that you might be aware of or no?
In December, that would have been the assembly.
Okay.
Because I hadn't opened for the city council.
But accepting that donation and saying that you're also supporting union workers and that you come from a union family.
No, it's not. Because, he and I had a discussion. And although we usually disagree on most items,
right,
and most things that impact upon the city of New York, because the city council is not just my district that I fight for, but it's the entire city that you work for.
All right, thank you, Assemblymember mm-hmm. Dickens.
Assemblymember Taylor, my yes. question is to you. In light of the fact that you've been a longtime pastor in Harlem, how do you respond to some critics who have said that you have flip-flopped on the issue of reproductive rights? And this is because in 2019, you voted against the Reproductive Health Act, which codified Roe v. Wade in New York. But in January of this year, you voted for the Equality Amendment, sending it to voters for a constitutional amendment in November, which was a similar bill yes. to the Reproductive Health Act.
Thank you, Vivian. That's a great question. Evolving. It took me a minute to get there. And I believe it was 2018 I voted down on that bill. And I had to evolve. I had a challenge, not just myself, but people around me were challenging me to say, we respect your beliefs. Will you respect women to have their choice and their voice? And that bill that I said yes to, even though I didn't need my vote, was one of those moments, the first time I had to identify and say, what you do here is your prerogative, your business. Women have a right to choose, and you're stopping them from making that decision by voting no. So it wasn't an easy place. And people can say you flip-flop. I'm proud of what I've done. It wasn't an easy place to get to, and I would do it again if I had to.
Just a follow-up to that yes. reply. So do you believe in the separation of church and state? And is it possible that you could evolve back?
No, you're asking me, can I flip back? I'm saying no. No. Okay. Thank you.
Thank you, Assemblyman.
Okay. I want to thank all the candidates for participating in our lightning round. We hope the voters feel a lot more informed and confident on the issues that matter the most in our community. Tough questions for a tough job. Now, for the candidates, 1 minute closing remarks, and we'll begin with you, Mr. Salaam.
Thank you. Tonight we heard from people who have been seasoned in their political space, and I think that's a great thing. I think the good thing about what we're seeing here is that I'm a person who's old enough to do something about the conditions that Harlem is experiencing and young enough to still seek counsel, still be able to talk to the people across the divide, still be able to use my so-called celebrity in a way that's meaningful so that we can talk to people on all spaces in City Hall to get the job done. The great thing about what I think we are experiencing is that, and I've said this before, is that we need to create a true A-team. And that true A-team looks like the folks who are already in public service, maintaining their seats, holding that power, bringing me in so that we can become a true A-team doing the work that we so desperately need as a people in Harlem, fighting for all of us and not just some of us. And I thank you for that privilege to be here.
Okay. Assemblymember Dickens.
I want to thank you, Let It Rip, and I want to thank you for having us here and allowing us this opportunity. I stand on the experience. We're coming out of a pandemic where many of our small businesses were closed up and many people were put out of work, and now brick and mortar offices are closing down. And so it's important that the community across the city of New York be able to have representation that has the experience, the knowledge, And I served in leadership in the city council. And the community asked me to come back to the city and to serve them because they're aware of the work that I have done and not just the work that I'm committed or promising to do in the future. And so that's why they asked me to do it, because they feel that with that leadership, it's a 2-year term. They feel with that leadership, with my ability, the successes that I had for the 12 years that I served in the New York City Council, and for the last 7 years in the state, that I have been successful for not only the Harlem community, but the city of New York.
Thank you, Assemblymember Dickens. Assemblymember Taylor.
Hey, thank you all so much for allowing me to be here. I'm excited. It has been a great joy to be here with you folks. I'm here and I'm running to fight for affordable housing, economic opportunities, making sure our kids stay safe and people get a second and third and a fourth chance, because it's there and it happens for other people. I want to see it happen in the District of Harlem and unify this community in a way that is never done. I'm available, accessible, I'm a hard worker, and I listen, and I am able to evolve, and I don't go back. It's interesting because I thought they would say, hey, he finally got it. They say he flip-flop. But you know what? I'm a hard worker, I'm accessible, and I stand on what I do. You can find me anywhere 24/7. When I walked 760 miles to Chicago against gun violence, when people said you couldn't do it, yes, you can, baby, and I'm glad to be here. I look forward to inviting you all into City Hall next year as a city council member for the 9th district.
And vote on June 27th, regardless. It's imperative.
Okay. All right, we're going to end it there. I want to thank our candidates, Assemblymember Inez Dickens, Assemblymember Al Taylor,
all of us,
and Mr. Yusef Salaam. And I want to express our gratitude to our panelists, Vivian Lee.
Absolutely.
And Ronnie Eldridge. We also would like to thank CUNY TV for granting us this opportunity to host this important special debate. Now, before we go, I think it's also fitting that we acknowledge and dedicate this debate to one of New York's greatest public servants, Bill Perkins. Like so many, we are deeply saddened by the loss of Harlem's native son, who dedicated his life to serve his community. Bill Perkins was a former New York State Senator and City Council member who fought tirelessly for the very issues we raised at this debate on behalf of the residents of District 9. Few words can capture his profound love and commitment to the people of Harlem and New York. Vivian, you've had the opportunity to interview him throughout the years. Ronnie, you served with him at the City Council, correct?
Absolutely. Mm-hmm. And there were just a few of us that really stood together, and we really actually made a difference. But Bill, with his elegance, his hat, his clothes, he was, and his strength and his determination to really make life better, not only for Harlem, I have to say, but for everybody.
He really was actually great to cover. I remember moving here a couple of decades ago, and he was always out there whenever there was a story to cover in the upper section of Manhattan, and he was actually great to cover as a reporter.
All right. Well, thank you, Ronnie, and thank you, Vivian. Well, that's all for now. We would like to encourage everyone to go out and vote. Early voting for the Democratic primary starts on June 17th and ends on June 25th, 2023. And Election Day is on Tuesday, June 27th. Once again, the Democratic candidates for New York City Council for District 9 are Assemblymember Al Taylor, Assemblymember Inez Dickens, and Mr. Yusef Salaam. I'm Kero Gishoro, and this is Let It Rip.